I'd like to thank Swedish and the International Foot and Ankle Foundation for the grant money. And I'd like to thank Rod for last night. It was a lot of fun, and it was fun to be around his children and his mother and dad. I really enjoyed that a lot. And all that food and good fellowship. So thank you very much. This is, I did a pilot study on how the foot affects the back, and there's actually four areas that we, parts of this study. The first one, we had people stand normally, and then we had them to go in 20 degrees of valgus or pronation, and then 20 degrees of varus or supination. And then the second part, I was interested in the core. If you talk about back problems, it seems like the world can change by just doing the core. So I wanted to look at the core and see how that played out. So we looked at the knees, the core, the pelvic tilt with the knees straight, and then we asked them to do a pelvic tilt with the 20 degrees of varus. I took the, I combined the first two and found a third part that we are going to look at. We're only going to look at standing in 20 degrees of varus, and then later using the core in 20 degrees of varus and see how much difference that made, the muscle difference. And then luckily, there was one person that had a disc, which we'll talk to you about at the end of this little. The criterion basically were these were asymptomatic people. We screened them. And then we went through the institutional review board at Swedish, and of course they signed consent forms. And I have no disclosures at this time. But my wife's here, and she might have something different to say about that. We used a standing MRI to do these measurements. We found there's only one in the state, and when I heard it, we had one here, I immediately came to the Neuroscience Institute and said, I want to do a research project, because I felt like I could really prove that the foot is directly related to the back. We used two measurements, the vertebral floor angle, in which we made lines across the end plates and then had measurements in relationship to the floor. And then the intersegmental angle, which basically shows you the curvature. And we did this with S1, L5, L5, L4, and L4, L3, L2. The latest studies that have been putting K-wires in the spine have measured about 7 degrees of extension and flexion. And one author concludes that there's only about 6 degrees. When you walk, there's only about 2.5 degrees of movement in the sagittal plane. To understand, I'm going to build on this, but to understand what's going on, we need to start with the anatomy. And so the soleus, of course, attaches up here to this transverse processus along the capsule, and actually the ligaments. And then it comes down and meets the iliacus and becomes the iliopsoas. But the most important thing about this slide is this inserts posteriorly. It's behind the femur, and most of the muscle is located kind of in front. The same thing with the adductor brevis. It originates from the anterior pubis anteriorly, but inserts in the middle line of the linea aspera posteriorly. And those two words I will say quite a few times. Same thing with the longus. It attaches in the front of the pubis, pubic symphysis, and then inserts in the linea aspera, almost in the middle of the femur. And then we have our adductor magnus, a very strong muscle that attaches to the pelvis. And again, all the way up and down. This muscle goes all the way up and down. When you pronate, your foot, because of the axis of the subtalar joint, is a 45-degree axis. It creates an internal rotation of the femur. This creates, the tibia and the fibula, and then this internally rotates the femur. And that, what this does is it internally rotates and tightens the iliopsoas. And the iliopsoas then creates a pelvic tilt because of the anatomical position of the muscle. And then it puts a lot of strain on the low back, creates lordosis. But one of the most important things, it not only creates lordosis, but it actually, because it's tightening, you're compressing the vertebrae. There's a tension that goes on there. And I think I'll mention that a little bit later. So all three of these muscles, when the foot internally rotates from pronation, you get tightening of the muscles, and it creates this anterior pelvic tilt. And I must say that this is very, very powerful. Once you're standing in a pronated position, these muscles, you can't get your pelvis posterior unless you either bend your knees or you supinate the foot. So this is what, but this, if you add extension to this, this is a static study, but I want to talk about dynamics here. So this is the iliopsoas. It attaches here, but it's being pulled posteriorly. You have to remember, at this time when they're walking, the leg's internally rotating, which is tightening it, and then the insertion's posterior, so it pulls this whole segment forward, creating this anterior pelvic tilt. And let me go back here. I wasn't able to stop this and show it to it, so I'm going to describe what happened. I bisected the heel, and I bisected the lower leg. So you'll see black lines there. I put two dots in the popliteal fossa, right, in the dimples behind the knee. You'll notice in gait, the person's going to land in a varus position, but the heel and the lower leg will be lined up. When you have foot plant, everything changes. The heel everts, and the angle of the lower leg gets larger, and you will see internal rotation of the knee. So I hope you visualize this. At heel contact, he's straight. And see, there's even space now at mid-stance between the knee. There's even stance at a heel contact, but once the foot hits the ground, everything torques inward above the ankle and knee. Now this one is extension. You bend the knee, but when the foot hits the ground, the leg extends. But it's also straightens. You'll see it not only bends, but it keeps straightening and straightening and straightening until toeing off. And that's important, because as long as the knee is straight and the foot's pronating, that pelvis has to be in an anterior position. Supination actually reverses all this. So what we did is we put these patients in 20 degrees of supination. And of course, this untightens the adductors, iliopsoas, rectus femoris, and other muscles, so there's not as much tension. And it allows the pelvis to have a posterior pelvic tilt. It relaxes, and so other muscles will be able to work. And I'll describe that to you in a minute here. So on your left, you can see with internal rotation, it causes tightening of the iliopsoas and the adductors and rectus femoris, and that pulls the pelvis forward. The second one is you supinate, it relaxes it. But the most important part about this slide is, in this slide here, the gluteals are not strong enough to overcome the adductors and iliopsoas. But in this slide, once you free up so there's not as much tension on this, the gluteals will kick in and the abdominals will kick in, and you get a lot more strength to allow this spine to be in a more normal position. So what we did here is we put them in 20 degrees of varus, the greatest change in supination, was 2.5 degrees of decrease with supination. So we actually decreased it, it decreased the lordosis at L5 by 2.4 degrees. Now this is a pronation and valgus. It only changed, I was surprised, it doesn't surprise me because most people when they're standing are pronated. So these change here didn't surprise me too much. But it did increase almost a degree. But what was striking is that when you look at the curvature and the intersegmental angle, three out of four of these increased. This increased quite a bit. This increased quite a bit. This one a little bit, but and this one was decreased. But you can see that with the valgus, you have an increased lordosis going on. So moving from there, I put the core in here because the core is just everything to every physical therapist. And so what we described as a core was the gluteals, contracting of the gluteals and your abdominal muscles to create a posterior pelvic tilt. And here, I want you to notice this because we've asked this person to do a pelvic tilt. And you'll notice when she does this, that the spine, the lordosis goes away, the kyphosis is greatly reduced. This is actually, I wish I had her head in there because I think the head would be in more line of the center of gravity. And then her butt. But you know she can't do it without bending her knees. And we don't walk around with bent knees. So if you ask anybody to do a pelvic tilt, they probably won't be able to do it almost universally without bending their knees or supinating their foot. So what we did is we had, this is the mid-stance position. Most people are pronating. And so we kept them in a mid-stance position. We didn't allow them to externally rotate or supinate their foot. And this is what happens. When you ask them to do a pelvic tilt, the gluteals and abdominals can't overcome the adductors and they fall backwards. So I created this test in the office called the Newell pelvic tilt test. And we added 20 degrees of varus and then we had them to do the pelvic tilt. And it's really easy after you supinate the foot to get the pelvis in a posterior position and reduce the lordosis. This is, so we put them in the standing MRI, kept their knees straight, did the two measurements of the floor to vertebral floor angle and the intersegmental angle. And then we did the same thing with supination and measured the angles. And on the front one, you can see there's a tremendous difference here. I think it's 3.6 degrees difference. And that's directly the pelvic, that's a pelvic tilt position. But you notice, we ask them to do right here, they're standing, and we're asking them to use their core, we're asking them to do their gluteals. We want them to fire these to reduce this curvature. And basically this curvature actually increases when you hold them. This actually gets worse from just normal standing. However, when we do the same thing with the knees straight and put 20 degrees in, we get a lot of reduction. And not only that, you see a small reduction, three out of the four in the relationship to the curvature. So the core is able to actually engage and help you decrease the lordosis. So I wanted to compare on this one, someone standing normally in 20 degrees of varus and they're not using the core. And then I wanted to add the core to this 20 degrees of varus. I put them in 20 degrees of varus and then I ask them to use the their core to fire. And we got a great reduction, which shows how powerful the core is in relationship to the back. And we assume that if there's a 3.1 degree reduction of the anterior pelvic tilt at S1, that if there was an average of 6 degrees of sagittal plane motion, that there's a 51% more, the core is 51% more efficient in getting that spine back. So, and again, we were encouraged by our findings, is we actually were able to reduce a little bit all the way along here in relationship to the lordosis. Now, this section here, I had written in my proposal that if we found an asymptomatic disc, that I felt like the disc would go away in supination. And I'm glad I put that in there because we're doing follow-up studies on that right now. So I got a call from the radiologist. This was a blind study. He didn't know whether they were recumbent, were they doing a pelvic tilt, were they doing a core. And he says, hey, one of your people have a disc. And so I said, great, I'm coming right over. And so I said, Rob, I want to predict when the disc will be there. And so I said, when they're standing, and when they're recumbent, it'll be a small disc. When they stand up, it'll actually be more protrusion. When they're pronated 20 degrees, it'll be significant. And when you supinate it, it'll go away. And then when you stand and do the core with the knee straight, without supination, it's still there. But if you stand and supinate them in 20 degrees, the disc went away. And all this is suggesting to me that once you get this, the reduction of the lordosis, you must decrease the intervertebral pressure by doing that, which allows that disc to kind of recede back. So I'm going to follow this up really quick because I want to talk about muscle weakness, how the gluteals and the abdominal affect the muscles above the waist. You're kind of familiar about how specific the weakness is below the waist, but this is a generalized weakness above the waist from your muscles to your neck. So the feet affect on the core, the low back, mid back, upper back, and neck muscles. I'm reviewing this with you to remember at mid-stance, your foot's straightening, the foot's internally rotating and pronating, and it's extending, and the pelvis is forward, and with supination, you reverse all that. And my hypothesis was if there's a decreased activity with the core muscles, there will be a decreased activity up to and including the neck muscles. So what we did is we looked at the core. We took superficial EMGs and placed them on the gluteus maximus and the abdominals. And then we looked at the muscle activity. And what we found here is this is the gluteals. And when we stood them and asked them to fire when they were just standing, he had about 55 of microvolts of activity within the muscle. However, if we supinated him, the gluteals went up to 80. We found the same thing with the abdominals. It was only 40 microvolts. But when we asked him to engage the core in 20 degrees of supination, it went up to over 90, maybe 95. So we thought that contributes to generalized weakness. And we feel this is true because the muscles overlap. And one thing about muscles, we think of them as isolated, but they're really orchestrated. They work together. If one muscle doesn't work, the other one's sort of shut down. And that's one of the things. The nerves overlap, the joints overlap. The nerves sometimes will go up as well as down. And of course you get impingement with lordosis and increased curvature causes a different position of center of gravity of the spine. These are the muscles overlapping, but you have to remember they're orchestrated together, they work together, nerves. So pronation promotes muscle weakness from the toe to the neck. Supination promotes muscle strength from the foot to the neck. So this is our man. He gives permission to use these slides. We did a biomechanical muscle testing, gait analysis. Then we hooked him up to the EMG. And we also have a handheld device that we're using here that will measure how much poundage the muscle will resist. So we tested him, we put him in 0 degrees of correction and 20 degrees of correction. And then we manually tested his deltoid. We tested his deltoid and his trapezius to see how strong they were. Of course, the time, and then we have a duration here, which is really interesting, of microseconds of how long that muscle could endure the poundage. So here he is on the left, and let me preface this. The one on the left is him standing flat-footed and asking him to hold his arm out. And then we were just manually testing him. And you'll notice how easy it is to push his arm down. So then we put him in 20 degrees of supination, and it's much harder. And so what we found with the EMG is that the deltoid had 80 microvolts, but in supination it went up to 104 microvolts. The trapezius went from 125 to 193 microvolts. But the duration was 3 times longer. Now, what surprised me about this, he could resist 17.5 pounds, and then he could go up to 21.6 for a longer period of time. But in our clinical experience, this was actually too much, usually most people. So I went back and did a retrospective study, and the arm strength usually is about 10.5 pounds. And it can only be held for about 8/10 of a second. If you supinate him, the arm will hold 20 pounds on the average, and then you can hold it for 5 seconds. Now, the trapezius. This is a deltoid. I think I can't quite read it, but I think it goes from 48 to 55 microvolts, and the trapezius is 44 to 101 microvolts. Now I'm going to ask you a question here. If you were operating in the cervical area, would you want that muscle firing at 44 microvolts postoperatively, or would you want that thing firing at 101 microvolts? Which one would give you the most stability? Which one would help you with your surgery? So again, my hypothesis is if there's decreased activity with the core muscles, there will be increased activity up and including the neck. So now we know about the gluteals, the abdominals, but what about the muscles in between? So what we did is we hooked him up to the EMGs, gluteals, rectus spinus, and this is the lowest part of the trapezius where it comes down here. And then we checked him, and you'll notice that when he was standing, the abdominal muscles were less than 40, but it went up to over 90 in 20 degrees. The rectus spinus didn't fire very much, and it increased, but not very much. And I think the reason these two have not increased very much. I'll tell you, because of the location of the EMG, because you remember the trapezius went from here to here. But in our original study, it went over to 100 microvolts if we checked it up by the shoulders. So a lot of this is displacement. But what it told me, and what I believe, is that once you can engage the gluteals, then everything in the back works in your favor. That is, its strength, it's all the muscles work and it will be firing much stronger. So we know that muscle weakness is a contributor to low back pain. But what I'm suggesting is the weakness in the upper and lower body comes from abnormal alignment most of the time. And with proper alignment, strength can come back. My conclusion is pronation creates abdominal and gluteal inefficiency or weakness. And when the gluteals and the abdomen muscles are weak, it creates a generalized muscle weakness and the spinous rectus and the trapezius and deltoid. And this is caused by the overlapping muscles. And I just wonder if there should be a pre-op and post-op evaluation to be done to determine which position the patient should be in before surgery. Thank you very much.